Orion Audiobooks present Tyrant by Christian Cameron. Read by Peter Noble. 333 BC. The sky above the dust was blue. In the distance, far out over the plain, mountains rose in purple and lavender, the most distant capped red by the setting sun. Up there in the ether, all was peace. An eagle, best of omens, turned a lazy circle to his right. Closer, less auspicious birds circled. Kineas felt that as long as he kept his attention on the realms of the heavens, he would be safe from his fear. The gods had always spoken to him, awake in omens and asleep in rich dreams. He needed the gods today. Noise and motion to his right distracted him, and his eyes flicked down from the safety of the empty spaces to the banks of the Pinarus River, the flat plain, the scrub, the beach, the sea. And directly in front of him, separated only by the width of the river, waited 30,000 Persian horsemen, their files so thick that they had raised a sand cloud, so deep that their rear ranks were visible over the cloud on the lower slopes of a distant hill across the Pinarus. His stomach clenched and rolled. He farted and grimaced in embarrassment. Nikeas, his hiperethes, gave a grunt that might have been a laugh.
"Look out, Kineas," he said, pointing to the right. "It's the boss."
Horsemen, a troop of 20 or so, their cloaks flashing with gold ornament, their chargers heavy and magnificent, cantered along the plain toward the edge of the beach where the allied cavalry waited for their doom. Only one was bareheaded, his blonde curls as bright as the gold gorgon's head that pinned his purple cloak, his horse covered in a leopard skin. He led them across the hard-packed sand to the general of the left, Parmenio, just half a stadia away. Parmenio shook his head and gestured at the hordes of Persian cavalry, and the blonde curls shook with laughter. The blonde shouted something lost on the wind, and the Thessalians in Parmenio's bodyguard roared and shouted his name, "Alexander! Alexander!" And then he cantered back along the beach until he reached the allied cavalry. 600 horsemen, all alone, to the front of the left wing. Despite himself, Kineas smiled as the blonde rode towards him. Behind him, the men of the allied cavalry began to cheer, "Alexander! Alexander!" It made no sense. Few of them came from cities with any reason to love Alexander. Alexander rode to the front right of the allied cavalry and raised his fist. They bellowed for him. He smiled, exhilarated, beamed at their approval.
"There's the great king, men of Greece, and at the end of this day we will be masters of Asia and he will be nothing. Remember Darius and Xerxes. Remember the temples of Athens. Now, Hellenes, now for revenge!"
And he rode easily, his back straight, his purple cloak rippling in the breeze, every inch a king, cantering across the front of the cavalry, stopping to say this to one, that to another.
"Kineas, our Athenian," he called.
Kineas saluted, raising his heavy machaira across his breastplate. Alexander paused, holding his horse with his knees, a horse that was a good 2 hands taller than Kineas's and worth 100 gold darics. He seemed to notice the great host of Persian cavalry for the first time.
"So few Athenians with me today, Kineas. Be worthy of your city."
He squared his shoulders, and his horse sprang forward. As he crossed the front, the cheers began again. First, the allied horse, and then the Thessalians, and then along the plain to the phalanxes.
Alexander!
He stopped to talk again, motioned with his arms, his head thrown back in the laughter that every man in the army knew.
Alexander!
And then he was riding faster, releasing his white horse into a gallop, with his escort streaming behind him like the cloak around his neck. And every man in the army was screaming it.
Alexander!
Parmenio grunted dismissively and rode over. He motioned for the allied hipparch and his officers to join him. He too gestured at the mass of Persians.
Too deep. Too packed together. Let them get to the edge of the stream and charge. All we have to do is hold until the boy does the work.
Kineas was younger than the boy, and he wasn't sure that he would hold his food down, much less stop thousands of Medes from pouring over the plain, then forcing their way into the flanks of the phalanx. He was excruciatingly conscious that he was here as a commander of 100 horsemen because his father was very rich and very unpopular for his support of Alexander, and through no merits of his own. The Attican horsemen behind him included a number of his boyhood friends. He feared he was going to lead them to their deaths, Diodorus and Agis, Laertes and Gracchus, and Cleisthenes and Demetrios, all the boys who had played at being hippeis while their fathers made the laws and sold their cargoes. Parmenio's voice snapped him back into the present.
You understand me, gentlemen?
His Macedonian Greek grated even after a year of hearing it.
The instant they reach midstream, you hit them.
Kineas rode back to the head of his squadron, almost unable to control his horse. Anxiety and anticipation by turns wasted and intoxicated him. He wanted it to be now. He wanted it to be over. Nicias spat as he rode up.
We're being sacrificed,
he said, fingering the cheap charm he wore around his neck.
The boy king doesn't want to lose any of his precious Thessalians, and we're just rotten Greeks anyway.
Kineas gestured at his troop slave to bring him water. He caught Diodorus's eye, and the tall, red-haired boy winked. He was not afraid. He looked like a young god. And beside him, Agis was singing an ode to Athena. He knew all the great poems by heart. Laertes tossed his throwing spear in the air and caught it with a flourish, making his mount shy, and Gracchus smacked him in the side of the helmet to get his horse back in line. The troop slave brought him water, and his hands shook as he drank it. Far away to the right, there were shouts, a long cheer, and the sound of Greek voices singing the paean. That could be either side. Plenty of Greeks over there. Probably more Athenians with the great king than with Alexander. Kineas looked to his front, tried to put his mind back in the ether, but the Macedonian phalanxes were moving to his right, shaking the ground, more a disturbance to be felt than anything he could see through the haze of dust they raised with their first steps. The battle haze. The poet spoke of it, and now Kineas could see it. It was terrifying and grand at the same time, and it rose to heaven like a sacrifice or a funeral pyre. But he couldn't get his mind above the dust and into the blue. He was right there on the beach, and the Persians were coming, and despite the shaking of his hands, his mind followed the actions of the battle. He could see the Macedonian taxes in the center moving through their clouds of dust. He could hear the shouts as the king moved the companions forward, and he felt the battle through all his senses as it flowed up the distant ridge. And the crash came as the center engaged, the great king's Greeks standing like a wall against Macedon's pikes. The Persians to Kineas's front took their time. Kineas was able to watch the phalanx roll into the riverbed and struggle to cross the gravel and climb the bank on the other side. Time to watch the Greeks and the Persian infantry meet them at the top of the bank and stop them cold. Dead men falling back down the steep banks to trip the men in the next rank as they climbed. Cheers on the wind from farther to the right.
Eyes front,
said Nicias. He kissed his charm. Just a stade ahead of him, a single Persian rider trotted into the stream and began to pick his way across. He waved and shouted, and the mass of Persian cavalry moved slowly down the shallow bank and into the Pinaros River. Philip Kontos, the Macedonian noble who commanded the allied cavalry, raised a hand in the air. Kineas's whole body gave a great shake and his horse shied a step, and then another, his tension communicated to the beast through his knees. He'd faced Persian cavalry just once before. He knew they could ride better than most Greeks, and that their horses were larger and fiercer. He prayed to Athena. Nicias started to sing the paean. In five words, every man in the front rank had caught it up, the volume of sound swelling and spreading like flame in an autumn field, a fire of song that sent sparks shooting across to the Thessalians behind them. The Persian cavalry was at midstream, a solid front of horsemen. Kontos dropped his hand. The allied cavalry began to walk forward, the horses excited, heads up, tails lashing. Kineas transferred his light javelin from his bridle hand, determined to perform a feat of arms he had practiced for 5 years, to throw his first javelin and fight with his second, all at the gallop. He measured the ground to the front of the Persian cavalry. The mass of Greek cavalry began to move faster, through a trot and into a canter, the paean shredding away as the hooves of the horses pounded out the sound. Kineas's mount left the sand and started down the shallow gravel bank of the Pinaros. He clenched his fist, signaling the charge, and Nicias's trumpet rang out. He was done being an officer. Now he would be a warrior. The wall of Medes in front filled his eyes, and the tension in his shoulders and his gut fell away. His mare's head stretched out with her stride, reaching a gallop. He jammed his knees and thighs like a clamp on her back and rose, his back straight, and flung his javelin at the closest Persian. And his weapon hand traveled down, following through, grabbing his second javelin and bringing it up as his horse's hooves bit into the water of the stream, and she collided, almost head-on, with the mount of the man he'd killed, his javelin through the man's body, his little mare like an equine javelin, knocking the larger Persian horse down into the water, its hooves flailing. A blow against his unshielded left side connected with his helmet and his arms. Pain. Kineas lunged at a big man with a red beard, swinging the head of his fighting spear like a long club, parried, and his own spear broke at the impact, the bronze head cutting the Persian's cheek as they passed so close that their knees touched. And Red Beard was now behind him, and he was unarmed. His horse was up to her knees in the water, her momentum spent, and one of the Persian horses slammed into her, chest to chest and head to head, so that both beasts rose out of the water like dueling personifications of the river god, droplets, a fountain of fire in the sun. The Persian stallion's rider lunged with his spear, and Kineas twisted away and lost his seat. In an instant, he was under the water, the riot of sound cut off. In a beat of his heart, Kineas had his feet under him, despite the weight of his armor, and his sword found its way into his hand as his head returned to the air and the din. His mare was gone, pushed aside by the bigger Persian horse. Above him towered a huge gray. Kineas hacked at the rider's leg, a clear blow. Blood blew from the wound, and then the rider was in the water, and Kineas was scrambling to mount, one hand locked in the grey's long blonde mane, the other with a death grip on the hilt of his sword, the water dragging at his legs, and his heavy breastplate pressing him down at every attempt to mount. A weapon rang off his helmet, turning it so that he was blind. A blade scored across his upper arm, scraped across the bronze of his cuirass, and then bit into his bridle arm. The grey, startled, bolted forward and dragged him out of the stream and up the bank he had so recently left, hanging from her mane, which panicked her so that she tossed her mighty head. Luck and the strength of her neck dragged him a hand's breadth higher than his best effort had reached before, so that he got a knee over her broad back. Another horse rammed into his side, the blessing of the goddess, as the new opponent served to push him up onto his new mount's back, although the stallion's teeth wreaked a toll on the bare flesh of his thigh. He struck out blindly across his own body with his sword, and it bit into flesh. With his bridle hand, he ripped the helmet clear of his head and flung it at the enemy he could now see. With his sword hand, he cut again, this time with intent, and his man was down. Kineas couldn't reach the reins. His knees were locked on the big mare's back, but he couldn't get her turned, and his back was to the enemy, his breastplate a sure sign that he was a Hellene and an enemy. He couldn't even see another Greek. He cut at a man coming behind him with a leveled spear and missed completely, almost losing his seat again. But the man with the spear rode by. Reckless or hopeless, Kineas leaned out across his new mount's neck and grabbed at the dangling reins again, missed again, had them, too hard a pull, and his mount was backing, rearing, then down on 4 feet. He turned into the stream and cut at a Persian. The man shied. Kineas thumped his heels into the flanks of his horse, and she moved deeper into the stream, bit savagely at a stallion in her path, while Kineas killed his rider, pushed further forward into the mass of Persians. And then he was on gravel, across the stream, pressed into a mass of enemies who could neither advance nor retreat because of their numbers. He was an evil surprise to them, pressed so close that their javelins were useless, and even his sword was too long, and his arm burned with effort every time he raised it. He was deep in their formation. He didn't think or plan. He hacked and hacked, and when the heavy sword was wrenched from his hand by the weight of a victim and the fatigue of his hand, he took his dagger from his belt, pressing his next enemy close so that he could smell the cardamom on the man's breath as he rammed his dagger into his armpit. He hugged his victim to him like a tired wrestler, and the body was struck a mighty blow that rocked him back on his mount. He let go, and the body fell between the horses. A javelin hit Kineas at the edge of his breastplate, the head punching into the sinew of his neck muscles before falling free. He tried to parry another blow, but his left hand wouldn't obey, and the man struck his cuirass with a sword so that it bruised his side, and then his horse pushed ahead, and the man was gone. He was at the top of the bank. He had crossed the river, and he felt as unafraid as if his spirit was high in the ether or already on the road to Elysium. Detached, aware in the last instance of his life that he was alone in the midst of his enemies, wounded 10 times. The instants stretched. This is how the gods feel time. And he was not dead. Or perhaps he was. He could only see as if down a long hall, so that it was difficult for him to feel threatened by the Persian he could see at the end of the tunnel in his head. He wanted to shout back across the minutes to the boy who had started the charge, "We will be a hero, you and I." The thought made him smile, and then the tunnel spun, and he felt a great blow on his back, sharp pain biting on his neck and heels. He didn't know until later that his boyhood friends Diodorus and Laertes stood over his body like Ajax and Odysseus and kept the Persians off until the battle was won. He didn't know until later that his action had broken the Persian cavalry. He recovered quickly, but not quickly enough to wear the wreath of laurel that Alexander awarded him as the bravest of the allies, or to hear his name cheered by the army. The wreath was pressed between boards of cedar in his baggage. 2 years later, another pair of cedar boards was pushed in beside it, pressing another wreath, one that cost him a scar 5 hands long down his right leg. He learned about war, about how much pain his body could endure, about cold and heat, discomfort, disease, friendship and ambition, and betrayal. At Guatemala, he learned that he had a gift for seeing the battlefield as an organic whole, the way a physician might see a body, diagnosing its ills and proposing remedies. He read the Persians well enough to save his part of the front when the Persians pressed close and all seemed lost. And again, he took a wound that put him down. A prostitute saved him from an ugly death on the battlefield, and he kept her for a while, and then a while longer. And then they pursued the great king to Ecbatana, where barbarian traitors brought the great king's head to Alexander in a sack. And the army knew that Asia was theirs, and theirs alone. Ecbatana smelled of smoke and apples. The smoke came from the campfires, as the whole army of conquest concentrated there after the death of Darius. The apples were everywhere, brought for the pleasure of the great king, and taken as spoil by the first units that came up the passes. For the rest of his life, Kineas loved the smell of apples and fresh pressed cider. Kineas was one of the first, and because of it, there were another 100 gold darics in his baggage. He had a fine sword with a gold handle, and he lay on a couch, his leman's breast under his hand, drinking cider from a silver cup like a gentleman, instead of standing by a campfire drinking it from clay or horn, like 10,000 other Hellenes. His woman wore a perfume that had come out of the palace, a scent that caught in his throat like the wood smoke. He was happy. They all were. They had beaten the greatest empire in the world, and nothing could ever stop them. Kineas never forgot the feeling of that night, the smell of smoke and apples, and her perfume, like a tangible Nike lying in his arms. And then his boyhood friend Diodorus, who had ridden with him from Issus to Ecbatana, an Athenian gentleman with a mind like a fox and red hair to match it, came in from his stint on guard duty, drank his cider, and said they were going home.
"The war of the Hellenes is at its end," Alexander said. He sat on an ivory chair and wore a diadem.
Kineas loved to follow Alexander, but the chair and the diadem made him look like a stage tyrant. He stood impassively with the other allied officers. If Alexander meant to impress them, his words fell flat.
"You have served the League brilliantly. There is a reward here for every one of you. If any of your men choose to stay, they will be enrolled with the mercenaries."
Alexander raised his eyes from the sacks of coins on the ground by his chair. He had heavy circles under his eyes from drinking, but the spark was still there, dancing away, as if something inside his head was on fire. Kineas wondered for an instant if there had been a mistake in phrasing, if he too would be welcome to remain and conquer the rest of the world. And then Alexander's eyes met his, and he read his dismissal. The officers were to go home. Alexander spoke on, ringing phrases of praise, rendered empty by the bags of gold at his feet.
"I'm done with you, go."
He lingered by the door of the king's tent when the other allied officers filed out, hoping for a kind word, an exception. But Alexander rose without another glance and left by another door. So, Kineas wondered if Alexander knew how much political poison smoldered among his precious Macedonians, but he clutched his thoughts close. He kept his own counsel when his leman left him for a Macedonian cavalry officer, one of many Philips, rather than travel home with him. And he was laconic when a deputation of his men came to him and asked him to remain and command them. Some suggested that they remain together and take service with Alexander's regent in Macedon, Antipater. Kineas had no interest in serving Antipater. In a day, he had realized that he had loved Alexander, not Macedon. He packed up his derricks and his wreaths, sold most of his booty, retained some fine cups for friends in Athens, and a wall hanging for his mother. He kept the sword and the heavy grey horse, and his stained cavalry cloak, and prepared to be a rich farmer. He had been away for 6 years. He would return a wealthy man, take a wife. The Athenians went with him. Cleisthenes and Demetrios were rotting in the ground, or walking in the groves of Elysium. But Laertes and Agis and Gracchus and Diodorus had survived battle and disease and misery and hardship. And Nicias. Nothing could kill Nicias. They rode towards home together, and no bandit dared ambush their convoy. When they reached Amphilopolis on the Greek mainland, none of the other young men were ready to press on. They lingered in the wine shops. Kineas hurried home. He found that he needn't have hurried. In Attica, he found that his father was dead, and that he himself had been exiled for serving Alexander. He fled north, to Plataea, where there was a community of Athenian exiles. He'd only been there a day when he was approached by an Athenian with a proposition. Of course, the man came from the same faction that had arranged his exile. But Kineas had grown up with Athenian politics, so he smiled and negotiated. And that night he sent Diodorus a letter, and another to a friend of his father's, another exile, on the Euxine. Part 1. The Shield of Achilles. Therein fashioned he also two cities of mortal men, exceeding fair. In the one there were marriages and feastings, and by the light of the blazing torches they were leading the brides from their bowers through the city, and loud rose the bridal song, and young men were whirling in the dance, and in their midst flutes and lyres sounded continually. But around the other city lay in leaguer two hosts of warriors, gleaming in armour, and twofold plans found favour with them, either to lay waste the town, or to divide in portions twain all the substance that the lovely city contained within. Iliad, Book 18. Chapter 1. The same squall that broached the Pentaconter, knocking her flat against the waves and filling her sail with water, swamped the smaller trading ship to the south. The smaller trader's cargo shifted, and she sank, the screams of her crew carried clear on the wind. The Pentaconter lay broached, the standing sail a testimony to the inexperience of her triarch, and the unshifting cargo a tribute to her sailing master's skill. The ship should have gone down anyway, lost on the Euxine with all hands, except that the sailing master hurled himself over the side at the mast, taking a bronze knife from a sheath around his neck and sawing at the lashings that held the sail to the yard. Under the awning in the stern, the triarch lay in horrified paralysis against the stem, unable to cope with the consequence of his disastrous decision to leave the mast stepped. The chaos on the rowing benches was as immediate a crisis as the sodden sail. The triarch had ordered the rowers to set the sweeps just before the squall hit, vainly trying to use the oars to keep her head before the wind. And when the ship broached, the wind-driven water had forced the long wooden shafts back in through the tholes, ripping them from the rowers' hands and crushing heads and rib cages. Two men were dead, one of them, the oar master. The ship's only passenger, a gentleman from Athens, had also lost his feet when the ship tipped, but not his head. He threw himself up, grabbing at the other side of the ship as it curved away from the stem above him, getting his feet under him. A glance showed him that the cargo had not shifted. Another, that the oarsmen were panicking,
Hard in there! He bellowed. Horsemen, larboard side!
His voice carried over the wind of the dying squall with ease. The habit of command and the expectation of obedience as strong as the sound itself. Every man in the waist who had any command of himself obeyed, men scrambling over each other in the rising water to grasp the side that was still out of the water. The sailing master cut the sail free. The passenger could feel the weight change, felt the deck move through a tiny arc towards an even keel. He flung himself over the gunwale, hanging by his arms with his whole weight outboard, and a few of the oarsmen copied him, adding their weight to his. The water in the waist shifted. The starboard gunwale rose above the surface, and the sailing master kicked himself clear of the sail and swam to the bow.
He swims!
Shouted the sailors and the oarsmen, to whom the ship was a man. Every sign of success rallied more men amidships.
Bail!
Shouted the passenger. Two of the veteran oarsmen already had the olive tree pump rigged, and water began to spurt over the side like arterial blood. Other men used helmets, pots, anything that came to their hands. By the time the passenger hauled himself inboard, the benches were no longer awash. The sailing master's attention was on the sea beyond him.
Another gust and we're dead. I have to get the bow up to the wind,
he said with a murderous glance at the trierarch. He shouted orders at the oarsmen and the sailors, who began to cut the mast itself away. One of the seams in the larboard side had opened when the ship broached. Water was coming in with every wave, and a cross wave with the impetus of the wind behind it flooded the waist again over the benches. The lack of an oarmaster told. The oarsmen hesitated, their hope destroyed by the second wave. The passenger flung himself into the waist, taking his own helmet from his baggage in the stern as he passed, and scooped water over the side.
Bail!
He ordered. And then, as men turned to the task, he started pushing men to their benches. He didn't know their names or where they belonged, but the force of his will was sufficient to move them. A long minute was wasted, dragging unbroken oars from the larboard side across to the starboard and feeding them into the tholes, and still the ship swam. At the first hesitant pull to the passenger's ringing shout, the ship moved a fraction of its own length.
Pull!
He bellowed again, taking his timing from a bandy-armed professional on the bench under his feet. Only 6 oars aside in the water, the ship full of water and her bottom filthy with weed. And again the ship barely moved. He sloshed to another bench, pushed 2 frightened men down onto it, and put the oar in their hands. Opposite there was a corpse filling the bench. He lifted the corpse, heavy beyond anything he could remember, and another pair of hands helped him fling his burden clear of the side, even as he called pull again. The oar shaft, free of the corpse, moved like a live thing and struck him a glancing blow in the shoulder that knocked him onto the bench. The man who had helped him caught it, lifted it clear of the water, and sat on the bench in one continuous motion. The passenger caught it on the return stroke, added his strength, and called pull as the oar reached the top of the stroke. Around the shaft went and down, the blade biting the water firmly. The oar felt alive under his hands. He raised his head and saw the sailing master aft, standing by the steering oar. He caught his eye, and the sailing master took up the call for the stroke, leaving the passenger to pull, his smooth, wet hands already feeling the weight of the oar.
Pull!
Called the sailing master. The fourth stroke, or the fifth, and the man at the steering oar called,
"He steers!"
And the sailing master gave him an order. Then came an hour of physical hell for the passenger, without the rush of overwhelming danger, just the pain in his shoulders and the sight of his hands turning to bloody pulp as he pulled on and on, water rising around his feet and then his thighs. Another squall hit them, and then another. They made no distance. Indeed, the sail was visible to starboard with every rise of the waves. All the oars could do was keep the head of the waterlogged vessel up to the wind, so that no wave could poop her. They did all that men could do, and they prayed to the gods. And just when the oarsmen were flagging and the heaves to keep her bow up to the wind were increasingly desperate, just when the second larboard oar caught a crab that threatened to endanger the stroke, the wind dropped, and before the passenger could look again at the ruin of his hands, the sun appeared between clouds, and then the clouds themselves were rarer, and then they were rising and falling in the swell of a sunny day on the Euxine, and they were alive. It was only when the wind fell off that the passenger could hear the thin cries from starboard over the rail, where some poor soul was struggling with the sea.
"Road of all!"
shouted the sailing master, his voice as raw as the passenger's hands. He was not used to calling the stroke for so long. The oars were tossed and pulled in, a ragged motion, but an efficient one, so that they crossed the benches and tucked their hand grips under the opposite thwart, their blades held clear of the water. The passenger's benchmate fell forward on the headrest thus provided, his arms over the oars, his cheek against their shafts. He breathed in and out. The passenger heard another cry from starboard. He pulled himself from under the crossed oar shafts, the residual salt water burning his hands like fire. His benchmate looked up at him and smiled.
"Well pulled, mate."
"There's a man in the water," the passenger replied, pulling himself up on an empty starboard bench. The hold beneath their feet was undecked, and there was water over most of the cargo. They were still barely afloat. The sailing master was seeing to it. He had the sailors, the deck crew, throwing bodies and anything else he deemed of no use over the side. Every minute lightened the ship, placed the thwarts a fraction higher out of the water. The passenger looked under his hand at the empty blue sea, the sun reflecting with blinding intensity from the wavelets, and listened for another cry. When he heard it, it was closer than he had expected. A man swimming weakly, but still afloat, just a rope's length from the bow. He dove before he thought the action through, and swam as best he could through the now smaller waves, the salt water chilling him and burning his hands all over again. He reached the survivor quickly, but the man tried to fight him, surprised at the touch, and fearing, perhaps, that Poseidon had come for him at last. The passenger shouted at him, took his long hair in a fist, and began to pull him towards the ship. The man's struggles endangered them both, but he took in a lungful of water, and his struggles ended. The passenger got him to the side. He was surprised at the hesitancy of the oarsmen to pull the man inboard, but they did. The man lay across an empty bench, alternating breathing and vomiting for a long time. The passenger came aboard, helped by more willing hands, to see the leather bag that held his armor and most of his tack being lifted towards the side. Slow from the sea's grip, he was still fast enough to get himself between the ship's side and his baggage.
"Don't!"
he gasped.
"Everything own!"
The sailing master stripped the bag from his crewman's hands and tossed it on the deck with a bronze clang.
"We owe you that much,"
he rasped. He pointed his chin at the long-haired man puking over a bench in the waist.
"They don't like him. Sailors don't take the prey from Poseidon. Shipwrecked men."
He left his thought unfinished, probably too superstitious to speak the belief aloud. The passenger was Athenian. He had different views on Poseidon, Lord of Horses, and his prey. "I'll look after him. We'll need every man on the benches to get this boat onto a beach." The sailing master muttered something under his breath, a prayer or a curse. The passenger went back to his bench. It was only when he had wiped the long-haired man's face clean of vomit and heard a gasp of Lacedaemonian-accented thanks that he realized that the Triarch was no longer aboard. They bailed and rowed all day, until they were once again in sight of the land to starboard. The shore of the Euxine was notorious for its lack of beaches, just endless rock, alternating with ugly, low marsh. The sailing master didn't try to force the men to get the ship ashore, despite the slow bleeding of seawater from the open seam. They ate dried fish, sodden with salt water, and felt better for it. They slept in watches, even the passenger, and pumped and bailed through the night, and the sun rose the next day to more of the same. Breakfast was skimpier than dinner. Small trading ships beached at night and carried little in the way of provisions. The amphorae of fresh water were point down in the sand of the hold, and most of their waxed caps were open, showing their empty innards to the blue sky. The passenger had no idea of the distance to their next port, but he had the sense not to discuss it. By midday, the rescued man was better, bailing with a will. He was careful when he moved, and quiet, obviously aware of his unwelcome status with the sailors and the oarsmen, clearly intent on earning a place by hard work. The fact that he was repeatedly seasick whenever the swell increased didn't help him. He was a landsman, and he didn't belong on the sea. He, too, had smooth hands and had never pulled an oar. And he had Spartan written on his head in every curling hair. The passenger arranged to take his turn at the pump with the stranger. He had to do most of the work. The Spartan was weak from seasickness and ordeal, and nearing the point of allowing events to overwhelm him. "I'm Kineas," he said on the upstroke of the pump. "Of Athens." Honesty forced him to add, "until recently." The Spartan was silent on the downstroke, putting all of his strength into it.
"Philocles," he gasped, "of Mytilene, gods of nowhere."
He gasped again as the pump handle went up. Kineas pushed down.
"Save your strength," he said.
"I can pump, just move your arms." The younger man's blood rushed to his face.
"I can pump," he retorted. "Do I look like a slave, not to honor my obligation to you?"
"Suit yourself," said Kineas.
They pumped while the sun burned down on them for more than an hour, and they didn't exchange another word. By nightfall, the last of the food and water was served out, and there was no hiding that the sailing master was at his wits' end. The mood of the oarsmen was ugly. They knew the way of things, and they knew that the triarch was gone. And they didn't approve, however much they might have paid for his error with the mast. Kineas had a lot of experience with men in danger, and he knew their mood too well. And he knew what the sailing master, who had already murdered the owner, would do to keep command. He took his bag to the bow early in the evening and sat on the bench there, ostentatiously cleaning the seawater from his cavalry breastplate and rubbing oil into his boots before putting an edge on his heavy cavalry sword and wiping the heads of his javelins. It was a display of deliberate intimidation. He was the best armed man on the ship, and he had his weapons to hand, and he lost new friends in the crew by letting them know it. Oblivious to what was happening, the Spartan lay opposite him on the bow bench, his anger spent in pumping.
"Cavalryman," he said,
surprised, his first word in hours. He pointed at the heavy boots, so alien to Greeks who went barefoot or wore only sandals.
"Where's your horse?"
He gave a fraction of a smile. Kineas nodded, his eyes on the men in the waist and the sailing master talking to two veteran oarsmen in the stern.
"They intend to throw you overboard," he said quietly.
The long-haired man rose to a sitting position.
"Zeus,"
he said.
"Why?"
"They need a scapegoat. The sailing master needs one too, or he'll be the sacrifice. He murdered the owner, do you understand?" The younger man's face was still green,
and his mouth looked pinched and thin. Kineas wondered if he was taking any of this in. He went on, more to think aloud than make conversation. If I kill the sailing master, I doubt we'll get this pig of a ship into a port. If I kill sailors, they'll drag me down in the end. He stood up, balancing against the swell, and hung the baldric of his sword over his shoulder. He walked sternward, apparently unworried by having half the crew at his back, until he knew he had the sailing master's attention. How long until we make port, sailing master? He said. Silence fell all along the benches. The sailing master looked around, gauging the mood of the crew, clearly unready for the conflict, if there was to be one.
Passengers should mind theirselves, not the working of the ship, he said.
Kineas nodded as if he agreed. I was silent when the Triarch raised the sail, he said pointedly. Look where that got me. He shrugged, raised his hands to show the bloody welts, trying to win over some of the crew. He got a few chuckles, a thin sound. I have to be in Tomis in a 10-day. Calchas of Athens expects me. He looked around, catching the eyes of the men in front of him, worried about the men behind him, because he knew from experience that frightened men were usually beyond persuasion. He couldn't say it more clearly. If I don't reach Tomis, important people will ask this crew hard questions. He saw it hit home with the sailing master and prayed that the man had some sense. Calchas of Athens owned half the cargo on this vessel.
We got no water, said a deck crewman.
We need oars, and that seam is opening like a whore in Piraeus, said one of the veteran oarsmen.
They were all looking at the sailing master now. Kineas felt the momentum change. Before they could ask more dangerous questions, he stepped up on a bench. Is there anywhere on this shore to beach and come at the seam? He asked the question in a light tone, but his position above them on the bench helped his authority.
I know a place, a day's easy road from here, said the master. Stow it, you lot. I don't discuss orders. Maybe the passenger has more to say.
Kineas forced a good smile. I can row another day, he said, and stepped down from the bench. In the bow, the sick Spartan had a javelin across his arm, the throwing loop on his thumb. Kineas gave him a smile, and then a shake of the head, and the long-haired man relaxed the javelin. We'll need every man, Kineas said conversationally, to no one in particular. His benchmate from the first hours after the broaching nodded. Other men looked away, and Kineas sighed because the die was cast, and they would live or die on the whims of the gods. He walked into the bow, his back to the sailors, and the sailing master called,
You there!
And he stiffened, but the next was like music to him.
You two fools by the mast!
Back to the pumps, you whore sons!
The two men by the mast obeyed. Like the first motions of the ship when the oars began to pull, the feeling on the deck moved a fraction, then a fraction more. And then, despite the muttering, the men were either back on their benches or bailing. Kineas hoped that the master really knew where he was and where they could beach, because the next time he didn't think his voice or his sword would be enough to cut the tangle of animosities on the deck.
Chapter 2 The two old men who kept the harbour light at Tomis saw the Pentaconter well out in the offing.
He's lost his mast, said one. Ought to have her stepped in this wind.
Rowers is done in too. He'll have a job of making the mole for dark, said the other.
They sat and shared their contempt for a sailor so foolish as to have lost his mast.
Gods on Olympus, look at her side, said the first, as the sun crossed the horizon.
The Pentaconter was well in with the land,
her bow only a dozen lengths from the mole. Her side was fathered with a length of linen and roughly painted in tar, a pitiful sight.
Them's lucky to be alive.
His companion had a pull at the nearly empty wineskin they shared, gave his cousin a black look, and wiped his mouth.
Pity the poor sailors, mate.
Truer words never spoken,
said his cousin. The Pentaconter pushed her bow in past the mole before full dark, her deck silent as a warship's, except for the call of the oar beat. The strokes were short and weak, and discerning eyes all over the port could see he'd pulled long past the ability of his oarsmen to look sharp or keep up speed. The Pentaconter passed the long wharf where the traders usually berthed, and ran her bow well up the pebble beach that fringed the river's mouth. Only then did the crew give a cheer, a sound that told the town all they needed to know about the last 4 days. Tomis was a large town by the standards of the Euxine, but the number of her citizens was small, and news travelled fast. By the time Kineas had his baggage over the side, the only man he knew in the town was standing with a torchbearer on the pebbles under the bow and calling his name.
Calchas, by the gods!
He shouted and dropped onto the shingle to give the man an embrace. Calchas gripped him back, first hugging him, then grasping for a wrestling hold, so that both men were grappling, down on the gravel in the beat of a seagull's wing, Calchas reaching around Kineas's knees to bring him down. Kineas, grappling the bigger man's neck like a farmer wrestles a calf. And then they were both standing, laughing, Calchas adjusting his tunic over his muscled chest, and Kineas rubbing the sand off his hands.
10 years, said Calchas.
Exile seems to suit you, responded Kineas.
It does too. I wouldn't go back.
Calchas's tone implied that he would go back if he could, but that he was too proud to say it. You got my letter. Kineas hated demanding hospitality, the lot of every exile.
Don't be an idiot. Of course I had your letter. I have your letter. A string of your horses and your hiperetes and his little gang of louts. I've fed them for a month. Something tells me you don't have a pot to piss in.
Kineas bridled. I will repay you. He began.
Of course you will. Kineas, I've been where you are.
He indicated Kineas's baggage with a negligent hand to his torchbearer, who lifted the bag with a heavy grunt and a long sigh.
Don't get proud, Kineas.
Your father kept mine alive. We were sorry to hear that he died, and you exiled, of course.
Athens is a city ruled by ingrates, but we haven't forgotten you. Besides, the helmsman says you helped save the ship. That's my cargo. I probably owe you.
He looked past Kineas in the dim torchlight as another man leaped over the side to the beach. The Spartan bent, his locks swinging to hide his face, and loudly kissed the rocks of the beach. Then he came up behind Kineas and stood hesitantly at his shoulder. Kineas gestured to him. Philocles, a gentleman of Mytilene. His pause was deliberate. He could see the confusion, even the anger, on Calchas's face.
He's a Spartan.
Kineas shrugged.
I'm an exile, said Philocles. I find that exile has this virtue, that no exile can be held responsible for the actions of his city. He's with you?
Calchas asked. His sense of hospitality and etiquette had eroded in the Euxine, Kineas could see. Calchas was used to being in charge.
The Athenian gentleman saved my life, pulling me from the sea when my last strength was nigh spent.
The Spartan was plump. Kineas had never seen a plump Spartan before, hadn't remarked it when they were at sea, but here in the torchlight it was obvious. Calchas turned on his heel, a rude gesture at the best of times, a calculated insult now, and waved up the beach.
Fine, he can stay with me too.
It's late to be out, Kineas. I'll save all my whatever happened to so-and-so questions for the new day.
If the Spartan was offended, he didn't show it. Very kind, sir. Despite days of physical labor and several restless nights, Kineas woke with the last of the night and walked outdoors to find the first sleepy slaves carrying water from a well into the kitchen. Philocles had spent the night on the porch like a servant, but it didn't seem to have affected him much, since he was still asleep, snoring loudly. Kineas watched the dawn, and when there was light enough to see, he walked down the lane behind the house to the paddock. The pasture beyond had 2 dozen horses, most of which he was pleased to see were his own. He walked along the paddock until he saw what he had expected to find, a small fire burning in the distance, and a man standing near it with a short spear in his hand. Kineas walked over the broken ground until the sentry recognized him, and then all the men were awake, 9 men with heavy beards and equally bandy legs. Kineas greeted each in turn. They were professional soldiers, cavalrymen with dozens of years of war and accumulated scars, and none of them had the money or the friends to aspire to the status of the cavalry class in a city. Antigonus the Gaul was more likely to be enslaved than made a citizen in any city, and he, like his friend Andronicus, had started with some other mercenaries sent out by Syracuse. The rest of them had once been men of property in cities that either no longer wanted them or no longer existed. Lycales was from Thebes, which Alexander had destroyed. Kinus was Corinthian, a lover of literature, an educated man with a secret past, a rich man apparently unable to return home. Agis was Megaran and Athenian, a well-born pauper who knew no other life but war. Gracchus, Theodorus, and Laertes were the last of the Athenian citizens, the last of the men who had followed Kineas to Asia. They were penniless exiles. Nicias, his Hipparetes for 6 years, came up last, and they embraced. Nicias was the oldest of them, at 40-some years. He had grey in his thick black hair, and a scar across his face from a Persian sword. He'd been born to a slave in an Athenian brothel.
All the lads who were left, and all the horses.
Kineas nodded, spotting his favourite pale grey charger out in the paddock. All the best of both. You all know where we're going? Most of them were still half asleep. Antigonus was already stretching his calf muscles like an athlete. They all shook their heads with little interest. The Archon of Olbia has offered me a fortune to raise and train his Hippes, his cavalry bodyguard. If he is satisfied with us, we'll be made citizens. Kineas smiled. If he expected them to be moved, he was disappointed. Kinus waved a hand and spoke with the contempt of the true aristocrat.
Citizens of the most barbaric city in the Euxine, at the whim of some petty tyrant, I'll just have mine in silver owls.
Kineas shrugged. We're not getting younger, friends, he said. Don't spurn the citizenship until you see the city.
Who's the enemy, then?
Asked Nicias, absently fingering the amulet around his neck. He'd never been a citizen anywhere. The whole idea was a fantasy to him. I don't know yet. His own people, I think. Not much up here to fight.
Macedon, maybe.
Diodorus spoke quietly, but with great authority. Diodorus knew more about politics than the others. Kineas turned to him. You know something?
Just rumor.
The boy king is off conquering Asia, and Antipater is thinking of conquering the Euxine. We heard it in the Bosporus. He grinned. Remember Philip Kontos? He's commanding Antipater's companions now. We saw him. He tried to hire us. The other man nodded. Kineas thought for a minute, his head down on one fist as he did when something puzzled him, and then spoke. I'll get you the wherewithal from the house. Write a couple of your famous letters and get me some information. In Ectabana and in Athens, no one ever mentioned that Antipater would march. Diodorus nodded curtly. Kineas looked them over. We lived, he said suddenly. There had been times when it seemed pretty certain that none of them would. Nicias shook his head.
Just barely.
He had a cup of wine in his hand, and he hurried to slop a libation on the ground for his apparent ingratitude to the gods.
Here's to the shades of them that didn't.
They all nodded. Good to see you all again. We'll ride together from here. No more ships for me. They all walked out to the horses, except Diodorus, who stayed as sentry. It was one of their invariable rules. They always had a sentry. Learned the hard way, justified too many times. The horses were in good shape, their hooves hard from the rock and sand in the soil, their coats shiny. They had 15 heavy horses and 6 light, as well as several pack animals. A former charger past his best years, but still willing. 2 mules they'd captured raiding Thracians with the boy king, and never quite lost. To Kineas, every horse had a story. Most were Persian chargers, from the spoils of the fight at the Issus River. But there was a bay he'd bought in the army market after the fall of Tyre, and the metal-grey charger, the biggest mare he'd ever seen, had been left wandering riderless after a skirmish at a ford on the Euphrates. The big horse reminded him of the other grey, the stallion he'd taken at Issus, long dead of cold and poor food. War was unkind to horses and men. Kineas found himself moved by how few of them were left, but his chest was tight with the joy of seeing them. Well done, all. I need a day or two. We're not due in Olbia until the Caristeria, so we have time. Let me get my legs under me and then we'll ride. Nicias waved his arms at them.
Leaving in a day. Lots to do, gentlemen. Tack, armor, weapons.
He began to issue suggestions, very like orders. And the other men, most of them born to wealth and power, obeyed him, although he had been born in a brothel. Kineas put his hand on his Hyperetes shoulder. I'll bring my kit down and join you this afternoon. Another habit. Every man cleaned his own kit like hoplites. Send Diodorus to me. I'm going to the gymnasium. Nicias nodded and led the rest of them to work. In what passed for the city, they had 3 things built of stone: the wharfs, the warehouses, and the gymnasium. Kineas went to the gymnasium with Diodorus. Philocles joined them as they left, and Calchas insisted on acting as their guide and sponsor. If the size of his establishment hadn't immediately given away his wealth, his reception in the agora and the gymnasium was ample evidence. In the agora, he was greeted with respectful nods, and several men solicited his favor as he walked through. At the gymnasium, the other 3 men were immediately admitted free of charge at Calchas's insistence.
I built this, Calchas said with pride.
He proceeded to catalogue the building's merits. Kineas, perhaps closer in his mind to Athens, thought it was satisfactory, yet provincial. Calchas's boasting grated on him. Nonetheless, the gymnasium offered him the best opportunity to exercise that he'd had in months. He stripped, dropping his borrowed garment on top of his sandals. Calchas guffawed.
Too long in the saddle!
He laughed. Kineas stiffened with resentment. His legs were a trifle over-muscled at the top, and his lower legs had never been much to look at. To his fellow Hellenes, who worshipped the male form, his legs were less than perfect, although he had to go to a gymnasium to be reminded of it. He began to warm up. Calchas, by contrast, had a hard body carefully maintained, although he had the beginning of a roll of fat at his waist, and he had long legs. He began to wrestle with a much younger man on the sand of the courtyard. Spectators made ribald comments. The younger man was apparently a regular. Kineas gestured to Diodorus. Fancy a couple of falls. At your pleasure. Diodorus was tall, bony, and ascetic-looking. He was not any Hellene's idea of beauty either. Kineas circled, waiting until the taller man stepped towards him to attack, and pushed in to meet him and get inside the man's long reach. Diodorus took the momentum of the attack into his arms and threw it over his hip, and Kineas crashed his length in the sand. He got up, slowly. Was that necessary? Diodorus was embarrassed. No. Kineas gave a bitter smile. If you're trying to tell me that your wrestling is of a different order than mine, I already knew that. Diodorus raised his hand. How often do I get a chance to use that move? You walked into it. I couldn't help myself. He was smiling, and Kineas rubbed the sore spot on his back and stepped forward for another hold. He felt a tiny twist of fear, the niggling fear that he carried into every contest, every fight. He went for a low hold, got a piece of it, and he and Diodorus ended up in an ugly mess on the ground, neither man able to pin the other, and both coated in sand and grit. By unspoken mutual consent, they both left off their holds and helped each other up. Outside, Calchas had pinned the young man he was wrestling. He didn't seem in a hurry to let him up, and there was a great deal of laughter from the other citizens. Kineas faced Diodorus again, and this time they circled and feinted and closed and recovered at a more normal tempo. It was almost dance, and Diodorus stayed to the movements of his gymnasium lessons, which kept Kineas comfortable. He even gained a fall. Diodorus rubbed his hip and smiled. Kineas had fallen atop him, a perfectly legitimate approach to the game, but one inevitably painful to the victim. Even? Even. Kineas gave him a hand up. Calchas was standing with the young man and some other citizens. He called out, "Come and wrestle with me, Kineas." Kineas frowned and turned his head. Uncomfortable with all these strangers, the twinge of fear strong because Calchas was bigger, a better wrestler, and as a boy in Athens had liked to use his advantages to inflict a little pain. Kineas disliked pain. 10 years of war had not accustomed him to dealing with sprains and bruises, and deep cuts that took weeks to heal. If anything, 10 years of watching men live or die at the whim of the gods had made him more afraid. He shrugged. Calchas was his host, a fine wrestler, and looking to demonstrate his superiority. Kineas gritted his teeth and obliged him, losing the first fall in some carefully fought grappling, taking the second fall by a matter of split-second timing that was more luck than skill, and which surprised both men. Calchas surprised him again by rising from the fall graciously, nothing but praise on his lips, and going on without rancor. 10 years ago, the adolescent Calchas would have come on for blood. The third fall was like the first, careful, at times more like dance than combat. And when Kineas was eventually pinned, the action caused the spectators to whistle in appreciation. Calchas was breathing hard, and his arms circled Kineas' waist as he helped him to his feet.
"You give a good match. Did you all see him?" he called to the others. "He used to be an easy mark for a fall."
Men hurried forward to compliment Calchas on his victory and to tell Kineas how well he had done. It was all a trifle sickening. A remarkable amount of praise lavished for so small a thing. But Kineas bore it in the knowledge that he had given a better guest gift than money. A memorable fight that left his host looking well. The young man that Calchas had wrestled earlier was quite beautiful as he came up to pay respectful comments to the wrestlers. Kineas was unmoved by male beauty, but he appreciated it as much as any Hellene, and he smiled at the earnest young man. "I'm Ajax," the young man said in reply to Kineas's smile. "My father is Isocles. May I say how well you fought? Indeed, I..." He hesitated, swallowed his words, and was silent. Kineas read him easily, He was an observant youth. He was going to say that Kineas had looked the better wrestler. A smart boy. Kineas put a hand on the smooth skin of the boy's shoulder.
I always imagined Ajax would be bigger.
He's heard that stupid joke his whole life, said the father. I try to grow to fit it, Ajax returned. And there was a smaller Ajax too.
Do you box? Care to exchange a few cuffs?
Kineas gestured at the straps for boxers, and the boy's face lit up. He looked at his father, who shook his head with mock indignation.
Don't get too cut up or no one will want to take you home from the symposium, he said.
He winked at Kineas.
Or should I say get cut up so you won't get taken home? Have kids of your own?
Kineas shook his head.
Well, it's an experience. Anyway, feel free to put a few welts on him.
Diodorus helped them both wrap their hands, and then they began, starting as if by mutual consent, with simple routines, blows and blocks, and then moving to longer exchanges, and thence to sparring.
The boy was good, better than a farm boy in an Euxine backwater had any right to be.
His arms were longer than they looked, and he could feint, rolling his shoulders to telegraph a roundhouse that never came, and then punching short with the off arm. He stretched Kineas, now fully warmed up and eager. A short blow to his cheek gave him some personal interest in the contest. And suddenly they were at it. Kineas was unaware that they drew every citizen in the gymnasium. His world limited itself to his wrapped hands and those of his opponent, his eyes and torso. In one flurry, each of them jabbed 10 or 12 times, parrying each blow with an upper arm, or taking one high on the chest to deliver one to the head. The flurry ended in a round of applause that moved them apart. They eyed each other warily, still charged with the daemon of combat. But the surge of spirit soon dwindled, and they became mere mortals in a provincial gymnasium again. They shook hands warmly.
Again,
said the boy, and Kineas shook his head.
Won't be that good again. Keep it as it is.
Then, after a pause,
you're very good.
The boy hung his head with real modesty.
I was going as fast as I could. I don't usually. You're better than anyone here.
Kineas shrugged and called over the boy's head to his father, proclaiming how talented his son was. It was an effective way of making friends in the gymnasium. Everyone wanted to congratulate him on his skill, on the beauty of the moment. It made him happy, but he needed a massage and a rest, and he said so, declining innumerable offers of further contests until someone said they were all going to throw javelins, and he couldn't resist. He followed them outside and felt a pang. Philocles, forgotten or ignored, was running laps outside, around a big field full of sheep. Kineas didn't know what to do with the Spartan, who seemed to have become a dependent. Gentlemen weren't supposed to be so bereft, but Kineas suspected that he himself wouldn't have been much different if he had washed up on an alien shore with no belongings and no home. He waved. Philocles waved back. A slave herded the sheep well down the field, and the men started to throw. It wasn't a formal game. Older men who were disgusted by their first throw took a second, or even a third until they were satisfied, whereas younger men had to suffice themselves with one throw. It would never have done at the Olympic Games, but it was comfortable, as the shadows shortened, to lie on the grass, mindful of the sheep turds, and watch the whole community of men compete. Kineas was conscious of his legs and the imperfections of his body, but he'd proven himself an athlete and was one of them now, making easy conversation with Isocles about the olive harvest in Attica and the problems of shipping olive oil. Calchas threw with a great cry, and his javelin came close enough to make one of the sheep move with unaccustomed speed. He laughed.
That's the best so far. I have a mind to throw again. They're my sheep. We could all eat mutton tonight.
Kineas was to throw next to last, and Philocles last, places of honour because they were guests. Theodorus had thrown early. A good throw, with no grunt or cry, beaten only by Calchas. Most of the other townsmen had been competent. But the youth Ajax had surprised Kineas by his poor throw. Isocles had beaten it, throwing well, if short of the final mark, and he'd teased his son. Kineas was used to throwing from horseback, and he threw too flat, but it was still a long throw. Again the sheep started, as his javelin landed close to them. Calchas winced.
"You've become an athlete, while I run to fat in exile," he said.
Philocles picked up several javelins before choosing one. He walked over to Calchas, who was talking business with another man.
"This is scarcely sporting. I'm a Spartan."
He said it with a smile, an overweight Spartan, showing a sense of humour. Calchas didn't understand. He indicated with a flick of his head that he'd been interrupted.
"If you can do better than we have, let's see it."
Nettled, Philocles gestured at the sheep.
"How much for the straggling ewe?"
Calchas ignored him, returning to his conversation, and then jerked his head around in time to see Philocles throw, arching his body and almost leaving the ground. The javelin leaped from his hand, flew high, and descended fast. It knocked the ewe to the ground, all 4 feet splayed, the bolt from heaven pinning her to the ground through her skull. There was a moment of shocked silence, and then Kineas began to applaud. Then they all applauded the throw and teased Calchas about his ewe, suggesting various prices for her, some obscene, until Calchas laughed. Most of the town's social interaction seemed to revolve around keeping Calchas pleased. Kineas didn't like to watch it. Isocles pointed down the field.
"Let's have a run," he said,
and they set the distances and were off, running for a while in a pack until the better runners grew bored and took off. They circled the field 3 times, a good distance, and finished in the yard of the gymnasium. Kineas was close to last and took some good-natured teasing about his legs. And then they headed for the baths. Tired and clean, with a couple of bruises and a general sense of eudaimonia, well-being that inevitably came to him from the gymnasium, Kineas walked beside Calchas. Theodorus had gone off with some younger men to see the market.
"You could do well here,"
Calchas said suddenly.
"They like you.
This fighting you do, it's no job for a man. In defense of your city, that's different, but
a mercenary, you squander what the gods have given you. And one day some barbarian's sword is in your gizzard, and there you are. Stay here, buy a farm, take a wife. Isocles has a girl. She's pretty enough, smart. A housekeeper. I'd put you up for citizenship after the festival of Heracles. By Zeus, they'd accept you today after that boxing."
Kineas didn't know what to say. It appealed. He'd liked the men. The citizens of Tomis were a good lot, provincial but not rustic, given to gross jokes and amateur philosophy, at all good sports. He shrugged.
"I owe it to my men. They came here to join me."
Kineas didn't add that something in him looked forward to another campaign.
"You can just as easily move on and take up service elsewhere. You're a gentleman, Kineas. You don't owe them anything."
Kineas frowned. "Most of them are gentlemen, Calchas."
"Oh, of course."
Calchas waved dismissively. "But not anymore, not really.
Perhaps Theodorus could be a factor, or your steward. And those Gauls, they should be slaves. They'd be happier as slaves."
Calchas spoke with authority and finality. Kineas frowned again and allowed himself to be distracted by a man lying in the street. He didn't need to quarrel with his host.
"A barbarian?"
he asked, pointing. The man in the street was plainly a barbarian. He wore trousers of leather and had filthy long hair hanging in plaits and a leather jacket covered in a riot of colourful decoration. And he wore gold. His jacket had several gold ornaments and showed spaces where other bangles had been removed. He had an earring in his ear and a cap on his head like a Thracian. And he stank of urine and vomit and bad sweat. They were almost on top of him. He wasn't asleep. His eyes were open and unfocused. Calchas looked at him with deep contempt.
A Sith. Disgusting people. Ugly, stinking barbarians. No one can speak their language. And they don't even make good slaves.
I thought they were dangerous. Kineas looked at the drunk with interest. He imagined that at Olbia there would be a lot of Siths, born to horseback, a dangerous enemy. This one didn't look like a warrior.
Don't believe it. They can't hold wine, can't speak, can't really walk, scarcely human. I've never seen one sober.
Calchas walked on, and Kineas followed him, albeit unwillingly. He wanted a better look, but Calchas was uninterested. Kineas looked back and saw that the drunk was rising unsteadily to his feet. Then he toppled again, and Kineas followed Calchas around a corner and lost sight of the Sith. He heard a lot about Siths at the symposium because he was the senior guest, and he introduced the topic. The wine flowed. The inevitable flute girls and fish courses followed each other in the approved manner, and then the older men settled in to talk, moving their couches together so that the younger men could relish the more amorous of the flute girls with a degree of privacy. Eyeing a black-eyed girl, Kineas had a brief pang that he was now considered old enough to make conversation. But he pulled his couch to the side, and when he was asked, he suggested that they all tell him about the Siths on the plains to the north. Isocles took the pitcher of wine from a slave and looked at Kineas.
They're not proposing we drink in the Scythian fashion, unwatered wine.
The young men yelled for it, but the older men held the day, and the wine was mixed at a sedate 2 waters to each measure of wine. While Calchas mixed the wine, Isocles looked thoughtful.
They're barbarians, of course, very hardy. They live on their horses. Herodotus has a lot to say about them. I have a copy at my house if you'd care to read it.
Honored, said Kineas. We read Herodotus when we were boys, but I had no idea I'd end up here.
The thing about them is that they fear nothing. They say that they are the only free people on the earth, and that all the rest of us are slaves.
Calchas snorted derisively,
as if anyone could mistake us for slaves.
Isocles, one of the few men who seemed willing to risk Calchas's displeasure, shrugged.
Deny it if you will. Anarchises. Does that name mean something to you?
Kineas felt as though he was back in school, sitting in the shade of a tree and getting interrogated on his reading. Friend of Solon, a philosopher, he said.
A Scythian philosopher.
Philocles spoke up from the end of the room.
A very plain-spoken man.
A whisper of laughter honored his pun.
Just the one, Isocles nodded at Philocles. He told Solon that the Athenians were slaves to their city, slaves to the walls of the Acropolis.
Nonsense, said Calchas.
He started passing cups of wine around the circle of couches.
Oh no, not nonsense, if I may.
Philocles was leaning on his elbows, his long hair framing his face.
He meant that Greeks are slaves to their notions of safety, that our incessant need to protect ourselves robs us of the very freedom we so often prate about.
Isocles nodded.
Well put.
Calchas shook his head vehemently.
Crap. Pure crap.
Slaves can't even carry arms. They have nothing to defend. Nor can they defend anything.
Philocles waved to the butler who had brought the wine service.
You there, he said. How much do you have in savings?
The slave was middle-aged. He froze at being singled out.
Answer him, said Isocles.
He was smiling. In fact, Kineas realized that not only did Isocles not mind twisting Calchas's tail, he positively relished it. The slave looked down.
I don't exactly know. 100 owls, sirs?
Philocles dismissed him with a wave. just my point. I've just lost all of my possessions to Poseidon. I do not have a single owl, and this bowl of wine, the gift of my esteemed host, will, once in my gullet, be the sum total of my treasure. He drank it. I am now as rich as I'll be for some time. I do not have 100 owls of silver. This slave does. May I take it from him? Calchas ground his teeth. As the slave's owner, he probably held the man's cash. No. Philocles raised his empty cup. No. In fact, you would prevent me from taking it. So it appears that this slave holds property and can defend it. And so would Anarchises say of us. In fact, he would say that we are slaves to the very act of holding our property. Isocles applauded, with a trace of mockery. You should be a lawyer. Philocles, apparently immune to the mockery, replied, I have been. Kineas sipped his wine. Why are the Scythians so free then? Isocles wiped his mouth.
Horses and endless plains. They don't so much defend their territory as wander it. When the great king tried to make war against them, they melted before him. They never offered him battle. They refused to defend anything because they had nothing to defend. In the end, he was utterly defeated. Kineas raised his cup. That I remember from Herodotus. He swirled the wine in his cup thoughtfully. But the man in the street today. He paused.
Achilles, Isocles put in. The drunk Scyth. His name is Achilles.
Had a fortune in gold on his clothes. So they have something worth defending. The conversation grew much duller as the merchants present squabbled over the source of the Scythian gold. After another cup of wine, that gave way to a mock scholarly debate on the reality or fiction of the tale of the Argonauts. Most of the men present insisted that the Golden Fleece was real and debated which river feeding the Euxine had the gold. Philocles insisted that the entire tale was an allegory about grain. No one listened to him. No one told Kineas anything useful about the Scythians, either. He drank 4 cups of watered wine, felt his internal balance change, and passed on the next cup.
It didn't used to be such a woman about wine,
Calchas laughed. Kineas didn't think he had done anything to react. But Calchas flinched from the look on his face, and the room fell silent. In a soldier's camp, that would have been an insult demanding blood. Calchas didn't mean it as such, Kineas could see, although he could also see that the habit of power had robbed Calchas of his social conscience. Kineas bowed and forced a smile. Perhaps I should go sleep in the women's quarters then, he said. Guffaws. Outright laughter from Isocles. Calchas's face grew red in the light of the lamps. It was his turn to resent an insult. The suggestion that his women might enjoy a visit from Kineas, however oblique. Kineas saw no reason to apologize. He upturned his cup and slipped away. Chapter 3. The next morning, he was up with the dawn again. He didn't have a hard head, and he didn't like to drink too much wine, however good the company. Once again, Philocles was snoring on the portico. Kineas walked past him, thinking that the man was certainly a nested set of surprises, contrasts within contrasts, and he barely knew the Spartan. Fat athlete. Spartan philosopher. He walked out to the paddock. One of the Gauls was standing sentry. This morning, Kineas raised a hand in greeting, and then went out to the paddock and got the grey stallion to come to him with a handful of dates. Then he was up on his bare back, his thighs clenched on the animal's ample sides, and the chill air of the morning was rushing past him as he cantered the length of the paddock. He jumped over the paddock rail without much effort on the stallion's part and headed north, off Calchas's farm and on to the rolling hills of the plains. He walked until the sun stood clear and red above the horizon. And then he made a garland of red flowers and sang the hymn to Poseidon, which the grey stallion liked. The stallion ate the rest of the dates and spurned the grass as too coarse. And then Kineas mounted and rode back towards the town, gradually pushing the stallion to his extended gallop until he was a god, floating on a carpet of speed. The stallion was scarcely winded when he pulled up at the edge of the market. He dismounted and led the grey along the street until he found an early stall holder with a jug of watered wine for sale by the cup. He drank deeply of the sour stuff until he came fully awake. The grey watched him, waiting for a treat.
"Good fucking horse,"
the Scythian said. He was standing by the stallion's rump. Kineas turned and saw that he was stroking him and cooing. The grey didn't resent it.
"Thanks, I think. Buy me for wine?"
the Scythian asked. The phrase rolled off his tongue as though he had said it 1,000 times. He didn't smell so bad this morning, and he fascinated Kineas. Kineas paid for more wine, handed a cup to the Sith, who drained it.
"Thanks. You ride for her? I see you ride, yes? Not bad. Yes, more wine, please."
Kineas bought more wine. "I ride all the time." He was tempted to boast, but couldn't see why. He wanted the Sith, a drunk, a beggar, but one with the value of a farm in gold about his person, to like him.
"Thanks. Rotten wine. You ride for old times. Me too. Need for horse, me."
He looked comical with his pointed hat and his terrible Greek.
"You got more horse? More?"
He patted the grey. Kineas nodded gravely. "Yes." The Sith patted his chest and touched his forehead. A very alien gesture, almost Persian.
"I call Achilles. You call?"
"Kineas."
"Show horse. More horse."
"Come along then." Kineas mounted with a handspring, a showy cavalry school mount. Before he could think about it, the Sith was mounted behind him. Kineas had no idea how he had mounted so quickly. Now he felt ridiculous. He hadn't intended to let the man ride with him, and they doubtless looked like fools. He took a back street and kept the stallion moving, ignoring the glances of a handful of early rising citizens. Something for Calchas to twit him with when he was up. They cantered up to the paddock. All of his men were awake, and Nicaeus had the paddock open for the grey before Kineas could call out. Nicaeus held the grey's head as they dismounted.
"He's been here before. Seems harmless. Might make a good procusatore."
Kineas shrugged.
"I have a hard time understanding him, but I think he wants to buy a horse and get out of here."
Theodorus was stretching his legs against the paddock wall. His hair was a tangle of Medusa-like red snakes in the morning, and he kept pushing the more aggressive locks off his forehead.
"Who can blame him? But if he's a Sith, he'd be a good guide."
Kineas made a quick decision and went over to the Gaul. "Cut the white-faced bay out and bring him here." Antigonus nodded and started pushing through the horses. The Sith walked over to the paddock wall and sat with his back against it, his leather trousers in the dirt. He didn't seem to mind. He seemed content just to watch the horses. When Antigonus brought him the bay, Kineas walked it over to the Sith.
"Tomorrow, we go to Olbia," he said slowly. "Sure," said the Sith, impossible to tell if he understood.
"If you will guide us to Olbia, I'll give you this bay." The Sith looked at the horse. He got to his feet, ran a hand over her, and leaped onto her back. In one stride, he was moving at a gallop and off over the wall of the paddock and up the road to the plain. For a group of professional soldiers, it was an embarrassment how totally he had taken them by surprise. He was gone, just a thin tail of hoof dust hanging in the morning sun before any of them thought of mounting or getting a weapon. Said Kineas. My fault. He seemed harmless. Nicias was still watching the dust, his hand on his amulet.
He didn't exactly do us harm.
He certainly knew how to ride. Kineas was watching the last of the dust under his hand. He grinned. The poet called them centaurs, and now we know why. There wasn't anything useful to be done about it. They didn't know the plains, and they didn't have the time to chase a lone Sith for days. Nicias put them all, even Kineas, to cleaning their tack and packing it tight for the next movement. They agreed that they'd leave the next morning. It wasn't that they were a democracy. It was just that they took orders better if they had participated in shaping them. Of course, Kineas took a good deal of teasing from the citizens. He'd lost them their pet Sith. Didn't he know better than to let a Sith up on a horse? Would he let a child play with fire? And more such. Calchas just laughed. I wish someone had woken me up to see you riding with that drunk. The things I miss. If he held any rancor about the night's revel, it was clearly dispelled by his guest's embarrassment of the morning. I'll be off in the morning. Kineas was indeed embarrassed, and caught his fingers smoothing the hem of his tunic. An old habit. Calchas watched the men around the paddock oiling leather.
I can't make you see sense and stay.
Kineas turned up his hands. I have a contract, my friend. When it is done and I have a talent or two in silver, why then I'd be pleased to have this conversation again. Calchas smiled. It was the first really happy smile that Kineas had seen in 2 days from the man.
You'll think about it? That's good enough for me. I have Isocles coming tonight, and his daughter will visit to sing for us. Family evening. Nothing to shock a girl. Take a look at her.
Kineas realized that Calchas, for all his overbearing ways, was working quite hard to make Kineas welcome. You, a matchmaker. Calchas put an arm around his shoulder.
I said it when you first came. Your father saved our whole family, I don't forget. You're fresh from the city. You think I'm a big frog in a little pond, I see it. And I am. Isocles and I, we argue about everything, but we are the men of substance here. And there's room for more. The pond's not that small.
For Calchas, that was a long, emotional speech. Kineas hugged him and got a crushing squeeze in return. Calchas went off to watch slaves being loaded for Attica. Kineas went back to working on his tack. He was sitting with his back against the outside of the paddock, using the wall for shade, with his bridle laid out in pieces and a new headstall to sew on, when young Ajax loomed above him.
Good day to you, sir, he said.
Your servant, Ajax. Please accept the accommodation offered by this tuft of grass. Kineas waved to it and passed a skin full of sour wine, which Ajax drank as if it were ambrosia.
My father sent this for you to look at.
He had a bag of scrolls over his shoulder, like a student in the agora. He hoisted it to the ground. Kineas opened one, glanced at the writing, a very neat copyist, and saw that it was Herodotus.
It is only book 4, the part about the Scythians, because, well, my father says you're leaving tomorrow for Olbia, so you won't have time to read much.
Kineas nodded and picked up the headstall. I probably won't have time to read the first scroll, he said. Ajax nodded. He then sat in silence. Kineas resumed his work using a fine bronze awl and the backing of a soft billet of wood to punch a neat row of holes down each side of the new headstall. He looked at Ajax from time to time from under his eyebrows. The boy was anxious, fidgeting with scraps of leather and bits of thread. But silent. Kineas liked him for his silence. He kept working. When the holes were punched, he waxed a length of linen cord and fitted it to a needle. The needle was too large for the job, but it was the only good needle in the camp. Then he began to sew. "The thing is," Ajax began. But he lost heart and the words just hung there. Kineas let them dangle for a bit while he finished his length of cord and threaded a new one. "The thing is," he said gently.
"I want to see the world,"
Ajax announced. Kineas nodded. "Laudable.
Nothing ever happens here."
"Sounds good to me." Kineas wondered if he could live in a place where the festivals and the gymnasium were the sum of excitement. But on this day, facing the loss of a horse, an uncertain journey and the tyrant of Olbia, he felt that a life of certain boredom looked preferable.
"I want to join your company, to ride with you. I can ride. I'm not much with a javelin, but I could learn. And I can box and wrestle and fight with the spear. And I spent a year with the shepherds. I can sleep rough, start a fire. I killed a wolf."
Kineas looked up. "What does your father say?"
Ajax beamed. "He says that I can go with you, if you are fool enough to take me."
Kineas laughed. "By the gods, that's just what I expect," he said. "He's coming to dine here tonight." Ajax nodded vigorously.
"So am I. And Penelope, my sister, is going to sing. She sings beautifully. And she weaves wool better than merchant's wool. And she's beautiful. I shouldn't say it, but she is."
Kineas hadn't encountered this level of instant hero worship before. He couldn't help but bask in the admiration for a little while. But not long. "I should be pleased to meet your sister. I will talk to your father tonight. But Ajax, we're mercenaries. It's a hard life. Fighting for the boy king. That was soldiering for the city in a way, even if we got a rough reception when we came home. Sleeping rough. Aye, and worse. Days without sleep, nights on guard, on horseback, in enemy country." His voice trailed off, and then he said, "War isn't what it was, Ajax. There is no battle of champions. The virtues of our ancestors are seldom shown in modern war." He stopped himself, because his words were having the opposite effect from what he had planned. The boy's eyes were shining with delight. "How old are you?"
17, at the festival of Heracles.
Kineas shrugged. "Old enough to be a man. I'll talk to your father," he said. And when Ajax started to stammer thanks, he was merciless. "By the crooked-minded son of Cronus, boy, you could die pointlessly in someone else's fight. A street brawl, defending a tyrant who despises you. Or from a barbarian arrow in the dark. It's not Homer, Ajax. It's dirty, sleepless, full of scum and bugs. And on the day of battle, you're one faceless man under your helmet. No Achilles, no Hector, just an oarsman rowing the phalanx toward the enemy." Wasted words. He hoped they were not prophetic, because he still had some Homer in him, after 10 years of the real thing. He dreaded the pointless death in an alley or a wine shop squabble. He'd seen them happen to other men. Late afternoon, and his tack was clean and neat. The horses were inspected, the other men as ready as they needed to be. The armor and cornel wood javelins packed in straw panniers for the baggage animals. He'd moved from the paddock to the base of the farm's lone oak tree with her blanket to repair. But Kineas found it difficult to keep his eyes open. The coming dinner reminded him of the girl, Ajax's sister, and what she would have meant. Home, security, work. And her mere mention reminded him that it had been months since he had lain with a woman. Probably not since he left the army. And the contrast seemed vivid. Without even meeting Ajax's sister, he could see her, at least in the guise of his own sisters. Demure, quiet, beautiful, remote, devout, cautious. Intelligent, perhaps, but certainly ignorant, without conversation. His longest liaison in the army had been with Artemis. Not, obviously, her real name.
She was a camp follower, a prostitute, although she insisted on being called Hetera and claimed that she would be one in time. Loud, opinionated, violent in her loves and hates, given to drinking undiluted wine. She had seen more war than most of the soldiers, for all that she wasn't yet 20. She'd stabbed a Macedonian file closer who tried to rape her. She'd fucked most of the men in his troop, adopted them, and been adopted. She had her own horse, could recite whole passages of Homer, and dance every dance the men could. All the Spartan military dances, all the dances of the gods. The night before a battle, she would sing. Like Nicias, she was born in a brothel near the Agora in Athens. She made the whole company, even the Corinthians and the Ionians, learn the anthem of Athens, to which she was fiercely patriotic. Come, Athena, now if ever, let us now thy glory see. Now, O maid and queen, we pray thee, give thy servants victory. She turned their drab followers into part of the company, got them messes, dealt with their squabbles, and ruled them, and gave them value. And she had said to Kineas one night, two things a girl needs to make it in this army, a hard heart and a wet cunny. That's not in Homer, but I'd wager that it was the same for the girls at Troy. Artemis was well known to pick a unit she liked and go to the strongest man in it until he died, or she grew restless, or he didn't provide for her. She wouldn't abide a non-provider. Kineas had kept her a year, in camp and city. She'd left him for Philip Kontos, a Macedonian hipparch, a good professional move, and he didn't hate her for it. Although it occurred to him, behind closed eyelids, under a tree on the Euxine, that he had expected her to stay with him. Like the women, the life. He didn't see much hope of becoming a farmer. He fell asleep, and Poseidon sent him a dream of horses. He was riding a tall horse, or he was the horse, and they flowed together on an endless plain of grass, floating, galloping on and on. There were other horses too, and they followed, until he left the plain of grass for a plain of ash. And then they neighed and fell behind, and he rode on alone. And then they were at a river, a ford full of rocks. On the far bank was a pile of driftwood as tall as a man, and a single dead tree. And on the ground beneath his hooves were the bodies of the dead. He awoke with a start, rubbed his eyes, and wondered what god had sent him such a dream. Then he rose and went to the house's bath, handed his best tunic to a slave to press, and gave the woman a few obols to do a good job. She brought him ewers of warm water to bathe. She was attractive, an older woman with a good figure, high cheekbones, and a tattoo of an eagle on her shoulder. Sex crossed his mind, but she was having none of it, and he didn't press the issue. Perhaps because he didn't, he got his tunic beautifully pressed, with every fold opened and carefully erased, the linen shining white, so that he looked like the statue of Leto's son on Mytilene. She accepted his thanks with a stiff nod, and stayed out of his reach, which made him wonder about the habits of the house. He walked naked back to where the men were camped. He had some good things in his baggage to go with his good tunic. He had good sandals, light and strong with red leather bindings that helped disguise the scar on his leg. But the only cloak he had was his military cloak, which had once been blue and was now a faded color between sky blue and dust. He did, however, have an excellent cloak pin, a pair of Medusa's heads in bright silver from the very best Athenian sculptor and caster. He pinned it to the old cloak with a muttered prayer, and slung the cloak over his shoulder anyway, out by the fire with Diodorus and Nicias. The other men had gone to the market to drink,
They hadn't been invited to the symposium, and since most of them were as well-born as Calchas, they chose to resent it. Agis and Laertes and Gracchus had known Calchas as a boy. They were angry at being treated as inferiors. Diodorus had a flagon of good wine, and he and Kinos and Nicias passed it around while Kineas finished dressing. Nicias held out a good brooch to put on his cloak, loot from Tyre, meant as a guest gift for Calchas.
"Save the Medusas for a more worthy host," he said.
Kineas wondered what Calchas would think if he knew that the slave-born Athenian on his back farm considered him a poor host, probably snort in contempt. His ruminations on Calchas were interrupted.
"Look at that,"
Nicias exclaimed. Kineas turned and looked over his shoulder. A lone horseman was trotting to the paddock. Kinas laughed.
"Achilles!"
bellowed Kineas. The Sith raised a dusty hand in greeting and swung his legs over the side of the horse so that he slipped in one lithe movement to the ground. He touched the flank of the horse with a little riding whip, and she turned and walked through the gate into the paddock.
"Horse good," he said.
He reached out a hand for the flagon. Kinas handed it to him without a moment's hesitation. The Sith took a deep drink, rubbed his mouth with his hand. Then Kinas caught the Sith in a bear hug.
"I think I like you, barbarian," he said.
Kineas shook his head.
"I thought you stole the horse."
The Sith either didn't understand or ignored the subject.
"Wherefore you go? Leave tomorrow, yes?"
"Yes, yes."
Kineas was conscious of the sounds of conversation from the drive. Isocles and his family were arriving. It was late. "Olbia," he said. The Sith looked at him. He handed the flask to Diodorus, as if he had always been part of their circle.
"Long?" he said.
"Far."
His Greek wasn't barbaric. He pronounced his few words well, but had no notion of the complex rules of cases that governed nouns.
10 days?
Asked Diodorus. That's what the merchants had said. The Sith shrugged. His eyes were back on the horse.
"You'll guide us?"
asked Kineas.
"Me go, for you. You go.
Horse good, yes?"
"I think that's a deal, boss."
Nicias nodded.
"I'll just keep an eye on the bugger, shall I?"
Kinas shook his head. "Achilles and I share a hobby. Let's go get drunk, my friend."
Achilles grinned.
"Think for like you too, Helen,"
he said to Kinas. They walked off together toward the wine shops of town. Nicias looked at Diodorus.
"I guess we get to watch the camp."
"While I go to a dinner party, excellent." Kineas grinned. "He'll make a superb scout if we can keep him." Nicias waited until Kinas and the Sith were out of earshot before going on.
"He's plenty smart."
Kineas had seen some intelligence in the face, but he was surprised to hear Nicias confirm it. "Smart, just how?" Nicias pointed at the horse.
"If he'd just stayed here with us, would we trust him on the plains? But he's already shown he could ride off, right? Stands to reason we'll trust him more."
Kineas saw it put that way. "You're as much a philosopher as that Spartan kid, Nicias." Nicias nodded.
"Always thought so.
And if he's a philosopher, I'm a hipparch in the guards.
Enlighten me." Kineas was actually standing on the balls of his feet, that eager to be in Calchas's house on time. But Nicias was not much given to bursts of conversation, and when he spoke, it was worth listening to.
"I heard from Dio about his javelin throw. He swam for an hour, maybe more, before you rescued him, or so I heard it. Spartan bastard. Out of shape, don't know why. But he's officer class, Spartiate. The tough ones, fucking killing machines."
"I'll bear that in mind," Kineas said.
"Don't marry the girl until we've done our contract," said Nicias.
Dismissed by his own hiperetes, Kineas headed for the house. He was still thinking about Nicias's comments when he found himself lying full length on a wide couch with the Spartan himself.
I hope you don't mind sharing with me,
Philocles said.
I asked Calchas to put me here. I think he was going to give you Ajax.
Thanks. The Spartan's breath was heavy with wine already. Kineas moved a fraction away.
You are leaving tomorrow?
Yes.
For Olbia?
Yes, that's where we have our contract. Kineas was finding it hard to talk to Philocles, a man who seemed immune to social convention, while the other guests, Isocles, Ajax, and a robed and veiled figure that had to be a woman, all stood, obviously waiting to be introduced to the principal guest before taking their ease.
Will you take me?
Philocles clearly resented having to ask. A good deal of suppressed arrogance was very close to the surface. Can you ride?
Not well, but I can.
Can you cook? Kineas was in a hurry to end this. Isocles had just shifted his weight. They were being very rude to the other guests. Why couldn't Philocles have kept this until the end of the meal? But he didn't want to say yes.
Not if you want to eat it.
Otherwise, yes. Kineas raised his eyes to Isocles and tried to pass a message. I know I'm being rude. I'm being importuned by someone whose life I saved. Isocles winked. The gods only knew what he thought was happening. I'll take you. It may be dangerous, he added weakly, too late to make any difference.
All the better,
said the Spartan.
Goodness, we're being rude.
We should greet the other guests. Isocles and Ajax greeted them and took their places on couches. The girl had vanished, probably taken to the women's rooms on the other side of the house. Dinner consisted of fish, all very good, lobster, a little undercooked, and then more fish, the sort of opson-filled meal that moralists in Athens complained of. Watered wine made the rounds, a series of slaves bearing in the ewers of wine, and Calchas mixing in the water himself. He was the only one alone on a couch, and he started conversations to include all of his guests. The wars of the boy king of Macedon, the hubris of the boy king claiming to be a god, the lack of piety in the younger generation, with the exception of Ajax. Despite his best intentions, he tended to launch monologues on his views on each of these matters. Ajax was silent and respectful. Isocles didn't rise to the arguments as Kineas had expected he would, and Philocles applied himself to the fish courses, as if he didn't expect to eat this well ever again. After the last food course, basins of water were brought, and all the men washed their hands and faces. Calchas raised a wine bowl.
This is really a family gathering, he said, to Isocles, my rival and brother, and to Kineas, to whom I owe everything I have achieved here.
He poured a libation to the gods onto the floor, and then drank the bowl to the dregs and upended it to show it was empty.
Since we are just family, it will outrage no god or goddess for your daughter to sing for us, Isocles.
I couldn't agree more, said the older man.
He took a full bowl of wine and raised it.
To Calchas, for hosting us to this excellent dinner, and to his friend Kineas, who we all hope will grace us with his presence for long years to come.
He, too, poured off a libation. Kineas realized that it was his turn. He felt out of place, shy, unaccustomedly foreign. He took a full bowl and rose to a sitting position. To the hospitality of Calchas, and to the making of new friends.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.